Right. Let's focus right there on verse in chapter 26, on verse number 21. Where the Bible says, And as they did eat, he said, Verily, I say unto you, that one of you shall betray me. And they were exceeding sorrowful, and began every one of them to say unto him, Lord, is it I? Now keep your hand here and turn. Don't lose this spot, but turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, we're going to look at verse 29. First Corinthians chapter 11, verse number 29, it says, For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world. Wherefore, my brethren, when ye come together to eat, tarry one for another. And if any man hunger, let him eat at home, that ye come not together unto condemnation. And then he says, And the rest will I set in order when I come. Now this passage here in 1 Corinthians is actually talking about the Lord's Supper, what we would also refer to as as communion. Now there's a strong parallel between these two passages. One thing I want to point out quickly though first, within 1 Corinthians 11, is that we see the phrase in verse number... Look at verse number... Start in verse number 29 again. We'll just read down through it. So he says in verse number 21, For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. And then he says, For if we would judge ourselves... We should not be judged. So he talks about judging yourselves. And then also in this passage, you have the famous quote in verse number 38. That's also in 2 Corinthians. It talks about examining yourself. So it says in verse number 28, But let a man examine himself, so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. And some of the strong parallels that you see, if you look back at Matthew chapter number 26, and you look at verse number 21, you see, he says, And as they did eat, he said, Verily I say unto you, that one of you shall betray me. And then you look at the very next verse, And they were exceeding sorrowful. So he tells them, one of you, while they're sitting at the Lord's Supper, the context of 1 Corinthians 11 is the Lord's Supper. And then over in Matthew chapter 26 is actually when the Lord's Supper, the Last Supper is also referred to, it actually occurs. And you see that he tells them, you know, one of you are going to betray me this night. And then they, after he says that, you know, they believe him. They've been with him for 3 years. They believe what he's saying. And after he says that, it says they began to be exceeding sorrowful. So they began to be very sorrowful. And then look what they say in verse number 22. It says they began, and they were exceeding sorrowful and began every one of them to say unto him, Lord, is it I? So they actually, at the Last Supper, all the disciples started doing exactly what Paul spoke about in 1 Corinthians 11. They started examining themselves. So you can see a parallel between these two passages. And the Bible teaches that communion, before we take communion specifically, we're supposed to examine ourselves and see if there's any sort of sin in our life. Turn to 1 Samuel chapter 6, verse number 1. You know, and when we take communion is not the only time that we should be examining ourselves. This should be taking place, you know, really on a daily basis. But there's certain things, you know, to some degree, it should be taking place on a daily basis. But there's certain reasons why we should be examining ourselves. So there's certain signs that should cause us to start looking at our lives and start examining ourselves. So here in 1 Samuel chapter number 6 is where the Philistines actually defeat Israel in battle. And they end up killing Eli, he's the priest. They end up killing Eli the priest's sons in this case. And they take the Ark of the Covenant with them. And they steal the Ark of the Covenant and they take it back to their land. And they put it in the temple of their god, Dagon. But look at verse number 1. We're going to start reading there in 1 Samuel chapter number 6. Verse number 1. And it says, And the ark of the Lord was in the country of the Philistines 7 months. And the Philistines called for the priests and the diviners, saying, What shall we do to the ark of the Lord? Tell us wherewith we shall send it to his place. And they said, If ye send away the ark of the God of Israel, send it not empty, but in any wise return him a trespass offering, then he shall be healed, and it shall be known to you why his hand is not removed from you. So it's talking about his hand not being removed from you. It's talking about God was afflicting them at that time. God kept smiting them. Because when they stole the Ark of the Covenant and they put it in the ark in the temple of their god Dagon, all kinds of bad things kept happening. All kinds of different curses kept falling upon them. You know, their god Dagon, their idol, you know, they ended up having his hands cut off and he was just left as a stump. And then they ended up also having all kinds of diseases and plagues that were coming upon them. So right now, they're thinking, you know, maybe it's the ark. And they're getting ready to send the ark back. So they're preparing the ark and they want to prepare it in an honorable way. They want to prepare it. They want to have reverence. They're thinking, if God's doing this unto us, you know, we're going to try to fix the problem. So he says in verse number 4. Then said they, what shall be the trespass offering which we shall return to him? They answered, 5 golden emeralds and 5 golden mice, according to the number of the lords of the Philistines. For one plague was on you all and on your lords. Wherefore ye shall make images of your emeralds and images of your mice that mar the land, and ye shall give glory unto the God of Israel. Peradventure, he will lighten his hand from off you, and from off your gods, and from off your land. Wherefore then do ye harden your hearts as the Egyptians and Pharaoh hardened their hearts, when he had wrought wonderfully among them? Did they not let the people go, and they departed? Now therefore make a new cart, and make 2 milk kine, on which there hath come no yoke, and tie the kine to the ark, or to the cart, and bring their calves home from them. And then he says in verse 8, and take the ark of the Lord, and lay it upon the cart, and put the jewels of God, which ye return him for a trespass offering, in a coffer by the side thereof, and send it away, that it may go. Now focus on verse 9. And see if it goeth up, by the way of his own coast to Beth Shemesh, then he hath done us this great evil. But if not, then we shall know that it is not his hand that smote us. It was a chance that happened to us. So notice here, when they send the ark away, they say, we're going to prepare the ark and we're going to send the ark back. And if the ark does this, if it goes this certain way and it goes up and it goes away from us, and then all of a sudden all the plagues stop, then we know for sure that it was God's hand that smites us, that was smiting us. But if we send it away, and it doesn't do exactly, the, you know, it doesn't go up the way that it's supposed to go up. If it doesn't go, it doesn't start heading towards Israel. And then all these things just continue, all these plagues just continue. They say, well, maybe it was just by chance that it happened to us. And this right here is good advice. And there's, you know, we have a lot of bad people. These are obviously the Philistines, which are heathens. They serve false gods. They weren't saved. They didn't serve the Lord. But sometimes the heathen you can find good advice from. And the way that you know that it's good advice is because they were right in this circumstance. They were trying to figure out, like, hey, what's going on here? And they're examining themselves. And they're trying to say, hey, what's the problem here? Is it something that I've done? Is it sin that is it because we've transgressed the Lord? Is it because ever since we've got this ark in our temple, all of a sudden we just start having all these problems? Maybe it's just by chance, or maybe it's sin in our life. And that's another time when we need to start examining ourselves. And we need to start looking and seeing, hey, maybe it's a problem that I've done. And if you're in your life, if you're just having one problem after another, it's possible that maybe it's a sin that's in your life. It's possible that maybe it's something you committed. I'm not saying it is for sure. I'm not preaching a health and wealth gospel, and I'm not preaching, you know, prosperity gospel or anything like that. Obviously, the Bible says, yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. So we're all going to have some sort of persecution in our life. But that's what it means to examine yourself. You're not sure. Maybe it's by chance that all this is happening, but maybe it's the hand of the Lord. Maybe it's God that's smiting you repeatedly. And the only way to figure it out is to get rid of sin, that particular sin in your life. So you have to look at yourself and you have to examine yourself and say, hey, what's the problem? What's going on here? Is it something that I've done? Or is it maybe just by chance that all this has happened to me? Now I'm going to have you, let's go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Actually, first, you know what? Turn to Hebrews chapter 12 first. We're going to look at an example of somebody, you know, not an example of someone, but we're going to look at passages where the Bible actually talks about different types of chastisement from the Lord. Because some people will just reject it. So obviously you have the prosperity preachers who will just tell you, you know, if you have any type of problems, and if you just don't have a Mercedes and a $500,000 house and everything's perfect every day, then you're living in sin. And obviously that's false. That's not what the Bible teaches, and that's not what the preachers of the Bible look like. Their lives weren't like that. But then you also have people that will just deny the chastisement of the Lord. People that will just say, God doesn't smite you. And a lot of times it's people that aren't saved, because this doctrine fits hand in hand with salvation. Because oftentimes when you preach the gospel at the door to someone, I remember probably one of the coolest salvations that I've ever personally got was a guy who was Hindu, and he was hardcore devout Hindu. And I got this guy saved at his door, and his whole family, you know, were Hindu. I could see him in the background walking around, and they were practicing Hindus. And the guy asked me, he was like, he basically said, you know, when I was telling him, like, once you're saved, you're always saved, I knew he was getting it, because he said to me, well, are you saying that, you know, basically, you know, after you get saved, after you believe on Jesus, that you can just do whatever you want, and then God isn't going to punish you? So people understand that when you preach the right gospel to them. But the people that preach the false gospel, they don't understand this doctrine. Oftentimes it's that group of people that fall into this category that will deny this doctrine and not understand why or when God chastises us. In Hebrews chapter number 12, we'll pick up in verse number 4, it actually explains that to us. It says, ye have not yet resisted unto blood, striving against sin. And ye have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as unto children. My son, despise not thou the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked of him. And then verse 6. For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth and scourgeth every son whom he receives. Whom he receiveth. There's no way around this verse. The Bible's very, very clear that God, if you are God's son, it says, for whom the Lord loves, he chastens. That's like a punishment. He chastens and scourges, and that's even more specific. That's talking about like a beating. He scourges every son whom he receives. And the reason why it says every son is because we're all sinners, because we're going to continually sin after we're saved. Now, you know, the unjust, the wicked, as far as, you know, they don't have Christ's righteousness, they haven't believed on Jesus, when they die, they don't get away scot-free. They're going to pay for their punishments in hell. Now, if we believe on Jesus Christ, we receive forgiveness, and we're going to heaven no matter what. We have eternal security. Nothing can separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. But if you just decide, hey, I'm just going to live a life however I want, I'm just going to, you know, live for the pleasures of sin for a season, you're going to be smite. You're going to be smote by the Lord in your life. God will punish you and God will chasten you. It says he chastens every son whom he receives. That's because we're all sinners, but it's a big difference if you just choose to willingly live in sin. God will punish you much more harsh. Turn to first back to 1 Corinthians 11. We're going to look at this again. Notice the word here in chapter number 12. Just remember the word where it said, for whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. And this is something that's taught not only just in clear statements and scriptures of the Bible. When Paul's writing a letter, whether it be Hebrews, whether it be 1 Corinthians, it's also taught in the book of Peter. Peter talks about the two types of suffering, whether you're suffering as a Christian or whether you're suffering as a murderer. And he mentions all these other types of sins. The Bible discusses this in epistles and things like that, just clear statements. But it also talks about the chastisement and the punishment of the Lord just throughout the Old Testament. Just throughout people's lives, you'll see God punishing people. And actually, you know, shortly after that passage in 1 Samuel, Saul ends up being punished directly by the Lord in a very similar situation where he goes out to battle and he ends up being killed. And the Philistines end up taking his body away as well. But look here at 1 Corinthians chapter number 11, and we'll start reading again. We'll just pick up back up in verse number 28. We'll read through here again. So it says, but let a man examine himself. And that's what I'm preaching about today, examining yourself. And the title of my sermon this morning is actually, Lord, is it I? Figuring out, hey, Lord, is it I? Is it my problem? Or is it by chance that maybe this is happening to me? It could be either one. But look at verse 28. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that cup, of that bread, and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. Now notice that. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. Now this could be an area like, hey, I'm sick all the time. It could be that God is smiting you. It could be a punishment. The Bible says very clearly right here, for this cause, because of sin, because of different things that the Corinthians had done, it says, for this cause many are weak, it says, and sickly, and many sleep. So death is one of those. I would say that these are more of the severe punishments that man receives when he's disobedient to God. More of severe sins that we would commit. God would give us, you know, this due punishment of being weak. But that is a sign, maybe, if you just keep getting sick, that's a possibility that God is smiting you. What did he do to the Philistines? He smote them with diseases. He smote them with plagues. And if actually, when you look in the law in the Old Testament, when God talks about the blessings and cursings, you know what most of the cursings are? They're sicknesses. They're diseases. They're all kinds of bad things happening to you. There's nothing worse and there's nothing more, you know, causing you just, you know, not to be mobile, not to get your, you know, everyday tasks done or to do things in your life. There's nothing worse than just being sick all the time. And that's why God will punish us. If we're disobedient to God, God will curse us. And a lot of times, it's being sick. A lot of times, it can be causing us to have infirmities. That's what it means when it says weak. Another way of talking about being sick. So it says, for this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. For, meaning because, if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord. Notice what it says there in verse number 32. But when we are judged, talking about judged by God, we are chastened of the Lord. Remember that word, chastened, talking about being chastised. He chastens every son whom he receives, right? We are chastened of the Lord that we should not be condemned with the world. So you know what you can learn from that verse? That there's a different condemnation for the world than there is with us. We have a type of condemnation. And the condemnation is if you're saved and you choose to sin, you choose to live, you know, a sinful life, you make all these bad decisions in your life and you just continue doing it, you'll have a condemnation. It'll be a chastening of the Lord while you're on this earth. It will be weak, sickly. It'll be maybe even sleep. That's referring to death. You'll have a type of condemnation. It's not the condemnation of the world. When they die, they'll have the condemnation, you know, of going to hell, of paying for their sins in hell. But there is a chastening. There's no way to deny that the Bible teaches that if you are a saved believer and you live in sin, you will be chastened by God, period. If you continue to live in sin, and the punishments will get worse and worse. And like I said before, one thing to keep in mind in our everyday lives is that if you willingly live in sin and you're aware of it, it's a much worse punishment, the Bible teaches. Yeah. The Bible talks about over and over again, even in the Old Testament law, there's sins that are presumptuous sins that if you just live in sin and you know what you're doing. And then there's also sins that are ignorant sins, like you're just not aware of it. If you willingly live in sin, your punishment will be much, much worse. Much, much worse. I'm going to have you turn to Psalms chapter 26, verse number 1. Psalms chapter 26, verse number 1. And Paul, there was another passage where Paul again advised the Corinthians. In 2 Corinthians, he advised them to examine themselves. So we see this come up over and over again. So it's not just something that applies to the communion. It says in 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse number 5, examine yourselves whether ye be in the faith. Prove your own selves. Know ye not your own selves how that Jesus Christ is in you, except ye be reprobate. So notice, he told them in another context, he told them in a completely different situation, that they needed to examine themselves. Matthew chapter number 6, 26, and this is my first point. We can learn this from the disciples. If you ever really wrap your mind around what's happening while the disciples are seated and they're eating at the Last Supper with Jesus, and he says in verse number 21, and as they did eat, he said, verily I say unto you that one of you shall betray me. So he tells his disciples, one of you guys are going to betray me. One of you will betray me. And they've been following Jesus around for 3 years, so they know that Jesus is God. These are, you know, the disciples, obviously, besides Judas. The disciples know and they believe that Jesus is God. They've seen, you know, that everything that he says comes true. They've seen the power of his words. So they, number one, their starting point is, I believe that, you know, what Jesus is saying is true. And it says in verse 22, and they were exceeding sorrowful and began every one of them to say unto him, Lord, is it I? And my first point is, in order for you to try to fix a problem in your life, in order for you to even start out examining yourselves, you have to be humble. And think about how the humility with the disciples, where they don't, I'm sure like John, who was the beloved, you know, who leaned on Jesus' breast, I'm sure he was probably the least expected. But this says that all of them started to look around at him, including John, including Peter, including the people that you would never suspect, people that weren't suspicious at all. They would look at Jesus and they would say, Lord, is it I? So they had a humble heart. They looked at God and they said, well, maybe it's even me. Is it me, Lord? They knew, number one, hey, somebody is going to betray him for sure. Obviously, you know, I would agree that, you know, that in the case of this situation, Judas was very deceitful. He wasn't very open and he wasn't very manifest about his wickedness and about how deceitful that he was. But I'm sure that there were other people that you could have suspected just as an outside viewer more than John or Peter. But even John, even Peter, when Jesus told him that, hey, somebody's going to betray me, the very first thing they said is, Lord, is it I? That's the attitude that all of us should have. That's the attitude that all of us should have, even if we're living in our home with our spouse. Even if it's, you know, and when a person hears that, if one of the spouses says, you know, well, yeah, you know, my wife or my husband, she really needs to hear that because she's the one that's got the problem. That's the wrong attitude. Each person, the wife, the husband, all of us, we need to say, hey, first thing that we should say is, Lord, is it I? We need to examine ourselves and try to figure out, hey, maybe the problem's something that I've done. Maybe not. Maybe it just happened by chance. But the Bible teaches that we need to examine ourselves. We should have a humble attitude when we come to Christ and when we come to, you know, problem where we're having problems in our life and we're trying to figure something out. We should have the attitude, Lord, is it I? Being humble. Now, you're at Psalms chapter 26, verse number 1. Psalms chapter number 26, verse number 1. You don't realize what a big difference. I left my Bible at home. You don't realize what a big difference, how hard it is to navigate through other Bibles. It was a Bible sitting here, so I just grabbed it. It's so much harder to flip to certain pages. Look at Psalms chapter 26, verse number 1, where it says, this is David speaking, judge me, O Lord, for I have walked in mine integrity. I have trusted also in the Lord. Therefore I shall not slide. And then watch what he says. Examine me, O Lord, and prove me. Try my reins and my heart, for thy loving kindness is before mine eyes, and I have walked in thy truth. One thing I want to point out, just as a learning tip, is you see some words here that are used synonymous, and they're used synonymously all throughout the Bible. Examine, prove, and try. And also judge. All of these words. Prove, judge, examine, and try are all throughout the Bible. They're always used synonymously. So you have there in verse number 2, David saying the same thing, having a humble heart. And he makes the statement, examine me, O Lord, and prove me. Try my reins and my heart. So in order to figure out what problem is in your life, in order to figure out if maybe it is, you know, some sort of sin that you've committed, you have to have a humble heart. If you don't have a humble heart, you'll never figure it out. It's the same way with salvation. If you're not humble enough to admit, hey, I'm a sinner, you're never going to get saved. Now imagine having some sort of serious chastisement or serious punishment that's in your life today, and it's never going to go away until you have a humble heart. The very first step is at least being able to admit, maybe it's me. Maybe it's something we've done, maybe not. That's why you examine. That's what it is, a diagnosis. You don't know that it's you when you start out, but there's certain steps that you can take. The first step to even begin to examine yourself is to have a humble heart. You need to be able to say, hey, examine me, O Lord, and prove me. Try my reins and my heart. Look at verse number 1, what it says there. Judge me, O Lord, for I have walked in mine integrity. I have trusted also in the Lord. So notice that, judge me. Now I'm going to have you flip over to Leviticus chapter number 24, verse number 9. Leviticus chapter 24, verse number 9. Here's some passages about being puffed up and what will happen in our lives if we try to puff ourselves up. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 12, "Wherefore let him that thinketh he standeth take heed lest he fall." So if you have the attitude like, "I know for sure it's nothing that I've done. I've been reading my Bible more than I ever have. I've been following God's commandments more than I ever have in my life. You know, I've been doing this, I've been doing that. I know for sure that it's not me. Maybe it's this person, or maybe it's that person, or maybe it's just by chance." If you automatically just have that attitude in the very beginning, it's probably even more likely that it's you. Even more likely if you think, "Hey, there's no possibility that it's me." That's probably even more so leaning towards the possibility that it's you. And here's the thing, yeah, even when we start reading our Bible more than ever, even when we start, going soul winning more than ever, we may start focusing on one area of our life and not even intentionally, you may start neglecting something else and start lacking in another area. So we need not to have this attitude where there's nothing that we can do wrong. We need to say, "Lord, is it I?" We need to be humble and say, "Hey, maybe this is God's hand smiting me. Maybe this is a problem that I have or something that I need to fix because of what I've done." Luke chapter 14, verse number 11 says, "For whosoever exalteth himself shall be abased, and he that humbleth himself shall be exalted." So you're in Leviticus chapter number 24, verse number 9. So what I wanted to point out about 26, and I'm going to tie in here in just a minute. Notice it said, "Judge me, O Lord." David said, "Judge me, O Lord, for I have walked in mine integrity." And then he said, "Examine me, O Lord, and prove me." Now you're in Leviticus chapter number 24. And in this passage, this is actually discussing where the man broke the Sabbath. He picked up sticks on the Sabbath. We're going to pick up and start reading. Whoops. Yeah. In verse number 9. Leviticus chapter number 24, verse number 9, it says, "And it shall be Aaron's and his sons, and they shall eat it in the holy place." Is this not the... Oh, no, we'll start reading in verse 10. Verse 10. And the son of an Israelitish woman, whose father was an Egyptian, went out among the children of Israel. And this son of the Israelitish woman and a man of Israel strove together in the camp." Actually, this is a different passage. I was confused about something here. And this son of the Israelitish woman and a man of Israel strove together in the camp. And the Israelitish woman's son blasphemed the name of the Lord and cursed. And they brought him unto Moses, and his mother's name was Shelemeth, the daughter of Dibri of the tribe of Dan. And they put him in ward. Now I want you to watch this phrase. "And they put him in ward that the mind of the Lord might be showed them." And then it says, I'll stop there for just a minute. Notice it says that the mind of the Lord. Now, what are they seeking to find out? When it refers to the mind of the Lord, what are they trying to figure out? They're trying to figure out what is God's judgment in this situation, right? They know this man has broken God's law. They know what the punishments are as far as they had the law at that time, but for some whatever reason that it is, they take this man and they keep this guy in ward and they say, "Hey, we want to try to see what the mind of the Lord is in this situation." So what they mean by that statement is they want to see what the judgments of the Lord are. What God would ordain or what God would appoint unto this person. They have the ability just to look in the law. They've already received the law. They already have the book of the law. They know what God's judgments are. But for whatever reason, they stop here and they say, "Let's put this guy away. We're going to try to see what's the judgments of the Lord. What's the mind of the Lord," it says, "might be showed them." Look at verse number 13 just to further prove that it's referring to the judgments. "And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, Bring forth him that hath cursed without the camp, and let all that heard him lay their hands upon his head, and let all the congregation stone him. And thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel, saying, Whosoever curseth his God shall bear his sin." Now I'm going to have you turn over to 1 Corinthians chapter number 2. 1 Corinthians chapter number 2. In the New Testament, there's two other times that we see that phrase, the mind of the Lord. Two times in the New Testament. It's only found three times in the entire Bible. One time it's found here in Leviticus chapter number 24. Then in the New Testament, in 1 Corinthians chapter number 2, we see that phrase again where it says the mind of the Lord. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter number 2 and look at verse 16 where we see the phrase. So it says, "For who hath known the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him?" And then he says, excuse me, "but we have the mind of Christ." Now to get the full context, go up to verse number 13. "Which things also we speak, not in the words which man's wisdom teacheth, but which the Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. But the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him. Neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned." Now watch verse 15. "But he that is spiritual judgeth all things, yet he himself is judged of no man. For who hath known the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ." So when he talks about the mind of the Lord here, what's he talking about? He's talking about the judgments of the Lord. And judgments just mean opinions or beliefs. What's your opinion on this subject? And when it said that the mind of the Lord was being sought back in Leviticus 24, what were they seeking? They were seeking for the judgments of God. They wanted to know what the judgments of the Lord were. Further proof that every time that the word mind of the Lord is brought up, that it's talking about knowing God's judgments, knowing the Lord's judgments, is in the other time that it's used in Romans chapter number 11, verse 33, it says this, "Oh, the depth of the riches, both of the wisdom and knowledge of God." And then it says, how unsearchable are his judgments and his ways past finding out. For who hath known the mind of the Lord, or who hath been his counselor?" So over and over again, when it's talking about knowing the mind of the Lord, it's talking about God's judgments. It's talking about having God's judgments or knowing God's judgments, that we would have God's judgments. And right here when it says comparing spiritual things with spiritual, it's referring to the fact that we have the Holy Spirit, right? That we have the Holy Spirit indwelling us. And we have the capability of understanding and discerning spiritual things. And the Bible is a spiritual book. The judgments of God that it was referring to in Leviticus chapter number 24, it was the law. It was the same words that we have in this book right now, right here sitting in front of us. So those judgments are spiritually discerned by us with the Holy Spirit and then reading, you know, the words which are spiritual. Jesus said, "The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life." And point number two is when we examine ourselves, we need to use God's judgments to try to figure it out. We need to use the Bible to try to figure out what is the problem. So you'd say, well, the Bible says in the New Testament, examine yourself, right? And then David said in Psalms, "Examine me, O Lord." Both take place. Because we have the mind of the Lord. We look at the Bible with the mind of the Lord and we use God and we allow God's judgments to discern what the problem is in our life. We go to God and say, "Hey, Lord, is it I?" That's where we find out where the problem is. And it may be something where you're lacking knowledge. It may, like I said, it might not even be it might not even be intentional that these sins are occurring in your life. But point number one is that we need to be humble. First, we need to have humility. Point number two is that we need to use God's judgments to find out what's the issue, what's the problem. Yeah, we examine ourselves, but we don't use our own judgments. We have the mind of the Lord. We know God's judgments. So we compare spiritual things, which is the Holy Spirit, with spiritual things, which is God's words, which is the judgments of God. Now, I want you to turn over to next passage is Hosea chapter number 4. Hosea chapter number 4. Hosea chapter number 4, we're going to look at verse number 4. We'll read a few verses here. We'll get more context. Normally when you hear this read, you just hear, I believe it's verse number 6. Yeah, we'll get more context. So we'll read we'll start verse number 1. "Hear the word of the Lord, ye children of Israel, for the Lord hath a controversy with the inhabitants of the land, because there is no truth, nor mercy, nor knowledge." Notice that, nor knowledge of God in the land. "By swearing and lying and killing and stealing and committing adultery." What are those? Those are the judgments of God. They don't have any knowledge of the Lord in their land. They're talking about they don't know the mind of the Lord. They don't know God's word. "Committing adultery, they break out and blood toucheth blood." Verse 3. "Therefore shall the land mourn, and everyone that dwelleth therein shall languish with the beasts of the field and with the fowls of heaven. Yea, the fishes of the sea also shall be taken away. Yet let no man strive nor reprove another, for thy people are as they that strive with the priest. Therefore shalt thou fall in the day, and the prophet also shall fall with thee in the night, and I will destroy thy mother. And then he says in verse 6, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because thou hast rejected knowledge, I will also reject thee, that thou shalt be no priest to me. Seeing thou hast forgotten the law of thy God, I will also forget thy children. And these are very, very serious curses and serious punishments that are coming upon the land of Israel. And we're in a very similar situation. And you know why the punishments were so bad for them? It's because they were God's chosen people. It's because at that time they had the Bible and they had God's Word. And they chose not to read the Bible. They chose not to seek after the mind of the Lord. They chose not to try to figure out, hey, why are all these bad things happening to me? What are all these problems? They just ignored it and they continued on. And then God says at the end in verse number 6, he says, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Now watch the next statement. Because thou hast rejected knowledge. They chose. They had the Bible just like we have the Bible. You had the ability of opening the Bible and trying to figure out and examining yourself and using, you know, the comparing spiritual things with spiritual things and trying to determine, is this something that's wrong in my life? Or is it maybe I just don't know about it. Maybe it's, and here's the thing. There are definite cases in the Bible where it talks about people just, you know, sinning willingly, and then, like I mentioned earlier, and then, you know, sinning ignorantly. But God doesn't excuse His judgment and His justice and His righteousness because of your ignorance. These people didn't know either, but they chose not to read the Bible. And you know what? They were punished anyways. So if you choose, hey, I'm just going to do whatever I want, I know I have the Bible, I know I have this, God knows your heart, and God will punish you even worse, just like God punished them. So if you're in a situation like, hey, it's crossed your mind and you're starting to realize, I've got a ton of sin in my life. I'm just having problem after problem after problem. Hey, maybe it's happening by chance, but maybe it's not. Maybe it's something that you've been doing, and maybe it's getting worse and worse and worse, and that there'll be a punishment in your life that's just going to change your whole life. You never know. God will punish you very severely. God will cause plagues and sicknesses that will come upon you, and you never know when you're going to receive mercy. You know, there were certain generations that lived in sin, and just because of the timing of what they did, they lived with the curse. After they had repented and after they had changed their ways, they lived with the curse until the day that they died. Like the children of Israel in the wilderness. Like those that were led into captivity right at the time that they were brought to Babylon. They lived with the curse until they died. I'm sure there were certain individuals that repented and said, hey God, I'm sorry for what I did. I'm sorry for the life I lived. You know, maybe these were saved people and they said, I want to change my ways. But you know what? It was too late. They had already rejected knowledge. They already had the opportunity and they just weren't seeking after the mind of the Lord. They weren't looking at the judgments of God and trying to figure out and examine themselves. And they didn't have a humble heart. They didn't say, hey, Lord, is it I? Maybe is it me? And that's my point number one has to continue on through the entire time. You can't just have a humble heart in the beginning when you start to look. You have to have a humble heart the whole time. While you're seeking the Scriptures, while you're looking to try to determine what the problem is, you have to retain the humble heart the entire time. Now turn to James chapter number 1, verse number 22. James chapter number 1, verse number 22. James chapter number 1, verse number 22. The Bible says, but be ye doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. For if any be a hearer of the word, and not a doer, he is like unto a man beholding his natural face in a glass. For he beholdeth himself, and goeth his way, and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. But whoso looketh into the perfect law of liberty, and continueth therein, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deed. So you can fall into a couple of different categories in this thing. You may not even be aware of the problem, and you might need to go to step number 2. You might just skip step number 2, but you might need to go to step number 2. You may not be aware of what the problem is. You might have to seek the mind of the Lord. You might be thinking, hey, I've got a lot of sin in my life, or I've got a lot of problems in my life. Maybe there's some sort of sin in my life, but I don't know what it is. Maybe you do need to go to the Bible and read the Bible more and try to figure out. Maybe just read through the law. Maybe there's some sort of, you know, some sort of law that you're breaking you're not even aware of, that you don't even understand you're breaking. But maybe you are willingly sinning, and maybe you do know what's going on. Maybe you know the problem, and the issue is that you're just a forgetful hearer. The problem is that you're a hearer of the word, and you're just not a doer of the word. And that's point number three, is that we need to apply it to our lives. You know, there may be one person that just needs to start with step number one, and they need to say to themselves, I need to have a humble heart because I want to fix my life. I want to have the blessings of God in my life. I don't want to be miserable the rest of my life. So they decide, hey, I'm going to have a humble heart, step number one. Step number two, I need to figure out what the problem is. I need to search the judgments of God. I need to see if there's a commandment that I'm breaking, whether there's any wicked way in me. Step number two. Step number three, now that I find the judgment of God, hey, here's a punishment, a serious punishment that has a serious penalty in the Old Testament. Now I need to start applying that to my life. Now I need to start, you know, not just being a hearer of the word. Now I need to start being a doer of the word. I need to start taking the word and implementing it in my life. I need to start changing my life. And this also, like I said, requires humility. That's why you have to have humility all the way through, even to the end. To the bitter end, you have to have humility all the way to the end until you figure out, hey, maybe it ends up being by chance. Maybe whatever's happening, you while you're looking for the problem, maybe just all of a sudden your life just starts getting better. Maybe it just happened by chance. That's possible. But maybe not. That's why it says examine yourselves. Nothing's for sure, but you're examining yourself maybe because it is something that you've done. Maybe there is some sort of problem that you've had. Turn to 2 Samuel chapter number 12, verse number 1. 2 Samuel chapter number 12, verse number 1. And this is the passage, this is immediately following, you know, the grievous sin, the horrible sin that King David committed. And King David is a great example in just about every area of life. He made some horrible mistakes, but if you read through his life, there's so much you can learn that we can apply to our life, and we can see that he had very positive things that he was doing that we're lacking in these areas. And that's why he's referred to as a man after God's own heart. So oftentimes, I'll tell you what I do when I want to, maybe if I'm reading the Bible, maybe if I'm wondering about something, or if I just want to have an example for something, I'll read certain people, certain stories about certain people. And if I remember, hey, I remember something happening to that person. Like, I remember Jesus being in this situation. Or I remember David being in this situation. If there's some situation that you're in your personal life, or there's something that's gone bad in your personal life, and you remember, hey, I remember that happening to David, but you can't remember what he did, then go to the story and read the story. And you can actually have a good example in your life. You know, so if there's maybe something you remember one time, like, hey, I remember that exact story in the Bible, go read it. It might be a story about a man that's a man after God's own heart. A story, a profitable example where you can learn something from it. So here in 2 Samuel chapter number 12 is when Nathan comes to David to confront him about his sin. So it says in 2 Samuel chapter number 12, verse number 1, it says, and the Lord sent Nathan unto David, and he came unto him and said unto him, there were two men in one city, the one rich and the other poor. The rich man had exceeding many flocks and herds, but the poor man had nothing, save one little ewe lamb, which he had bought and nourished up. And it grew up together with him and with his children. It did eat of his own meat and drank of his own cup and lay in his bosom and was unto him as a daughter. And there came a traveler unto the rich man, and he spared to take of his own flock and of his own herd to dress for the wayfaring man that was come unto him, but took the poor man's lamb and dressed it for the man that was come to him. And David's anger was greatly kindled against the man. And he said to Nathan, as the Lord liveth, the man that hath done this shall surely die. Hath done this thing shall surely die. And he shall restore the lamb fourfold because he did this thing, and because he had no pity. And Nathan said to David, thou art the man. Thus saith the Lord God of Israel, I anointed thee king over Israel, and I delivered thee out of the hand of Saul. And I gave thee thy master's house and thy master's wives into thy bosom, and gave thee the house of Israel and of Judah. And if that had been too little, I would moreover have given unto thee such and such things. Wherefore hast thou despised the commandment of the Lord to do evil in his sight? thou hast killed Uriah the Hittite with the sword, and hast taken his wife to be thy wife, and hast slain him with the sword of the children of Ammon. Now therefore the sword shall never depart from thine house, because thou hast despised me, and hast taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be thy wife. Thus saith the Lord, behold, I will raise up evil against thee out of thine own house, and I will take thy wives before thine eyes, and give them unto thy neighbors. And he shall lie with thy wives in the sight of this son. For thou didst it secretly, but I will do this thing before all Israel and before the sun. And David said unto Nathan, to watch his response, I have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said unto David, the Lord also hath put away thy sin. Thou shalt not die. So obviously what David did was horrible. It was a major, major sin what David had done. But David, when he was confronted about it, he had the right attitude. He was humble about it. Now in David's case, it says that he despised the word of the Lord. He despised God's judgments. Saying he just didn't want to even retain God, this particular judgment in his mind. He despised the judgment because he wanted to do something wrong, implying that David knew that it was wrong. Of course David knew that it was wrong. The Bible says that the king was commanded to read every day of the law. Read every day therein. The king was commanded. So he knew the judgments of God, and he chose to live this life, you know, to go ahead and to commit this sin in his life. But one thing that we can learn, there's many things that we can learn, but one thing that we can learn, which is like our point number one, our step number one, is that we need to have a humble heart, number one. Number two, the number two point that we need to do is we need to know God's judgments. Now, in David's case, he knew God's judgments, so he didn't need to seek his problem out. His problem was just, you know, right in his face. It was very obvious. God sent Nathan unto him. And David was already aware about it. He just needed to be confronted. Once he was confronted, he continued to be humble. Number three is we need to apply this in our lives. We need to stop. We need to basically repent of what we had done. Obviously, repenting of your sins or repenting in the sense of changing your life doesn't save you. But as saved Christians, we should be repenting of our sins. We should be trying to not sin in our life. And if you just continue to sin, you will be punished. You will be punished very severely. And David, in this case, was punished very, very severely. So we need to be humble. We need to have a humble heart. And like it says there, when David says, I have sinned against the Lord. The very last point, my very last point is, when we sin and we find out what the judgments of God are, yes, we need to apply it to our lives, but we also need to confess it to God. We need to pray to God and tell God, I'm sorry. You know, I know what I've done is wrong, and I'm going to make sure that I change, that I put forth effort to not do this any longer. I won't commit this sin any longer. I'm sorry for what I've done, and we need to ask for forgiveness. But here, I have two other small sub-points in conclusion. But one other thing is that even if you find out what it is, and even if you do, forsake that sin and confess it to God, you may still receive a punishment for a period of time after that. God may still punish you. What you've done may have been very serious. Maybe it's just by chance, like I said. Maybe it'll just stop. Maybe the plague will just go away. Maybe your sickness will just go away, whatever it may be. But maybe it is the hand of God. Maybe you find out there is a judgment here. Maybe you see, hey, I have broken this law. And you do all these things. And then the punishment for a period of time continues and then it stops. Well, that probably was judgment coming in your life. Because look at verse number 13 here. So it says, and David said unto Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said unto David, the Lord also hath put away thy sin. Thou shalt not die. So David received forgiveness in this situation from God. God automatically forgave him. But God can forgive us, but still give us a punishment for what we have done. He can say, I forgive you, but you're still receiving your punishment. You're just not getting away scot-free with this. David's punishment in this case was supposed to be, he was supposed to be put to death for committing adultery. And David in this case was not put to death, but there was still a punishment in his life. Look at verse number 14. Howbeit, because by this deed thou hast given great occasion to the enemies of the Lord to blaspheme, the child also that is born unto thee shall surely die. And Nathan departed unto his house, and the Lord struck the child that Uriah's wife bare unto David, and it was very sick. David therefore besought God for the child, and David fasted and went in and lay all night upon the earth. And the elders of his house arose and went to him to raise him up from the earth, but he would not, neither did he eat bread with them. So David has the right attitude now. If he could do anything to receive mercy, he's acting in the right manner of the way that he should. He's doing what he should to try to receive mercy from God. Listen to what he says. Look at verse 18. We'll pick up back in verse 18. And it came to pass on the seventh day that the child died. And the servants of David feared to tell him that the child was dead. For they said, behold, while the child was yet alive, we spake unto him, and he would not hearken unto our voice. How will he then vex himself if we tell him that the child is dead? So he's saying he afflicted and vexed himself. He was sad while the child was alive and hadn't even died yet. How much worse is he going to react when we go and tell him that the child has died, that the child is dead now? Look at verse 19. But when David saw that his servants whispered, David perceived that the child was dead. Therefore David said unto his servants, is the child dead? And they said, yes, he is dead. So David committed a horrible sin. And when David was confronted, he had the right attitude. He was humble about it. He admitted, I'm wrong. I've sinned against the Lord. He confessed his sin. And he had the right attitude about what he had done. But David still received his punishment. David still was punished. And that's possible that could happen in your life too. You may have followed all the right steps. You may have figured it out. But it is possible that it's too late. So the advice would be to the person that maybe it's not too late by. The advice would be given to the person like, hey, if you just continue to live in sin and you're aware of that today, you don't want to keep going down that road where you do get to the point where it is too late and something bad happens, something very bad happens, depending on what type of sin that it is. And this was one of the things that was listed in 1 Corinthians 11. He said, for this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we wouldn't be judged of God. It says, when we're judged of God, we're chastened of the Lord. And this is chastisement of the Lord. And in the book of Psalms, David talks about different chastenings of the Lord and God punishing him. But right here we see David, in this case, did have the right attitude, but he still received his punishment. Now, in your life, if you follow all these steps, because this is a bulletproof method to get sin out of your life and to relieve the chastisement, to relieve the smiting of the hand of the Lord from your life. This is what the Bible teaches you would do from beginning to end. If you follow all of these steps, but you're still having punishment in your life, you're still having God's punishment in your life, and you're sure like, hey, this isn't by chance. This isn't something that's just happening, by coincidence. I know that this is God's punishment, or at least you really feel like it is. You're really sure that it is, but you can't. You have a humble heart and a sincere heart, and you just can't figure out what it would be. This is what you should do. Job chapter 6, verse 24, Job says this, teach me, and I will hold my tongue, and cause me to understand wherein I have erred. So what you should do if you just can't figure it out and you're still very sure, like, hey, I think that this is something that I've done, and you've searched the judgments of God, but you can't figure it out, then you go and you pray to God and you say, God, if there's some wicked way in me, like David said, if there's any wicked way in me, or right here, like he said, cause me to understand wherein I have erred. If there's a problem that I have in my life, if there's a sin that I have in my life, I just want to be happy. I just want to be blessed. Please, Lord, just let me know. Cause me to understand that. And the greatness of that is because that we are comparing spiritual things with spiritual things, which is referring to the Holy Spirit. God will. The whole purpose of the Holy Spirit, the number one purpose, or one of the major, let's say one of the major purposes of the Holy Spirit, is to guide us into all truth. So when we go to God and we read God's Word and we pray to God and we ask Him, is there some type of chastisement? Is there a problem? Maybe you're depressed. Maybe whatever it is. I don't know what it is. Maybe it's some kind of problem in your life and you can't find out what it is, the judgments of God. Just pray to God and ask God, is there any problem? Is there something where I have sinned? And God will show you what that is. I am 100% positive. I have no doubt that if it is punishment from God, and if it is affliction from God, and He's vexing you, it's the hand of the Lord that's smiting you, God will show you wherein you have erred, like He says here. But like I said, I'll leave on this note. I'm not saying that you're being punished. I'm not saying that for sure it's God that's punishing in your life. Maybe you just make dumb decisions just every day. That's possible too. Maybe you just need to have better discernment in your life and make better decisions. It may not necessarily be a sin, but you just do stupid things. You know, that is a possibility. Number one. Number two, maybe it just happened by chance. Maybe just you've had bad, you know, like people would say bad luck. Maybe it's just happening by chance over and over again. You know, just the way things are working out. You know, you could pray to God to help you with that. Just please guide me, be with me, and direct me, and keep me safe when I go around. Maybe it just happened by chance. But we do need to examine ourselves. We need to look at ourselves. And sometimes we need to say, if there's a problem in our life, Lord, is it I? Am I the problem? So let's bow our heads and have a quick word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, God, we thank you for your word, dear Lord, and we thank you for all the teachings about so many great virtues and values that we should have in our life about being humble, dear Lord God, and having the right attitude. And we thank you for that you gave us the recipe to try to find out if there is a problem in our life, if there is some sort of sin that we have, so that how we can have relief. And we just thank you for that. We ask you, Lord, just to be with us, dear God, and to help us to understand your judgments and help us to have knowledge of your judgments that we might hide them in our hearts so that we're not going around and ignorantly sinning, that we would know your judgments. And we ask you just to be with us and keep us safe and just bless the rest of our day. In Jesus Christ's name, amen.
Amen.